I will speak in English, above all for the benefit of Italian speakers in the audience. Your Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased and grateful to be here tonight in this exquisite and historic setting to address a most distinguished organization whose work I have followed with interest and admiration in my nearly 10 years as a journalist covering the Holy See. In promoting the study and dissemination of Catholic social doctrine among business and professional leaders, the Centesimus Annus Pro Pontificia Foundation provides a service for which I think there is an ever greater demand and an even greater potential audience. That audience consists of Catholics and non-Catholics who are concerned about the pressing challenges of globalization, including the themes of this year's international conference, the role of business in the fight against poverty, and the response to the refugee crisis. So I thank the chairman, Mr. Domingo Sugrania-Spiegel, and the rest of the foundation for extending me this honor, and I join them in thanking our host, Ambassador Eduardo Gutierrez Sáenz de Buruaga, for his most gracious hospitality this evening. On a personal note, I am particularly happy to visit this embassy for the first time tonight, because my main experience of Spain is a delightful year that I spent in Madrid 2 decades ago, studying the life of the court of the 16th century King Philip II at the Royal Monastery of the Escorial. Among the many rewards of that experience was a lasting appreciation for the importance of relations between the Kingdom of Spain and the Holy See. Finally, I should, as a journalist, thank the Holy Father, Pope Francis, since his surprise announcement today about a commission that will study the question of women deacons came early enough in the day that it did not keep me from joining here tonight. So this is a very cosmopolitan gathering, but I hope you will forgive me for doing something rather parochial by referring to recent events in my own country, since I believe these events are highly relevant to the concerns of this conference in the broadest sense. I believe this is the case not only because events in the United States often have strong international repercussions, for better or for worse, but also because this particular predicament of the United States is one also faced by much of the developing world today. The last months and weeks, as you probably know, have been a period of extreme turbulence in American politics, bringing changes that deserve to be called radical and perhaps even revolutionary. In one of the country's two major political parties, a socialist, proponent of an ideology that has traditionally occupied no more than a marginal position in U.S. politics, remains in the running for the presidential nomination. Even more remarkably, the other major party has, in effect, given its nomination for president to a man who comes from outside the ranks of its established leaders, a businessman who has never held elected office and who contradicts major elements of the party's program as it has stood for more than 3 decades. Americans and much of the rest of the world will be puzzling over the implications of these changes long after this November's election. The economic roots and ramifications of these events are naturally of particular interest to business leaders. Among the most heatedly debated issues in this presidential campaign have been migration, international trade, and the nature and the extent of the United States' long-term military commitments abroad. But no factor in this massive political shift has been more important than the changes over the last few decades in the conditions and the nature of work. Since the year 2000, in acceleration of a longer trend, the U.S. has lost more than 5 million manufacturing jobs. Technology has eliminated some of these jobs, and globalization has moved others to lower cost locations abroad. New jobs often require specialized training or else pay too little to permit one or even two parents to support a family. For many without higher education or specialized skills, these developments have been a catastrophe, marking an end to the American dream of upward mobility to the middle class by means of so-called blue-collar work. Not coincidentally, this socioeconomic bracket of the U.S. population has undergone a social crisis, with rising levels of drug and alcohol addiction, single-parent families, and suicide. Against this background, proposals to limit international trade and reduce immigration have drawn the support of many voters. Whatever the merits or defects of such proposals, Any long-term solution to the employment problem will involve the creation of jobs that can give their practitioners a sense of dignity. Not only adequate wages, but the esteem of society and the personal satisfaction that comes from mastery of responsibilities proportional to one's talents. This is, of course, also a challenge beyond the shores of the United States. As Pope Francis told European leaders last week when he received the Charlemagne Prize here at the Vatican, progress on the continent requires that its young people find employment, dignified labor that lets them grow and develop their handiwork, their intelligence, and their abilities. Perhaps jobs of this kind will come in part from the rediscovery of traditional crafts and trades. Most will probably have to be invented. Jobs in which workers use and add value to the technology with which they can no longer compete. I know that the Centesimus Annus Pro Pontificia Foundation is planning a series of initiatives to explore the moral implications of recent advances in digital technology, including the powerful impact of that technology on the question of employment. The provision of dignified employment depends in part on the efforts of legislators and educators, but the greatest responsibility surely lies with business leaders, whether they be individual entrepreneurs, executives in large corporations, or the managers of cooperatives. According to a document published by the Pontifical Council for Justice and Peace in 2012, fostering dignified work is part of the stewardship of productive organizations. That is the vocation of the business leader. This vocation also involves practicing the virtues of justice and practical wisdom in leadership of what St. John Paul II called a community of persons at the service of the whole of society. This vision is idealistic. It might even strike us as romantic, but it is not unrealistic. I can say so on the basis of my personal experience. My late father was an entrepreneur who over his four-decade career provided work for several hundred full-time employees. He always treated his employees with respect and loyalty and tried to give them as much responsibility as they could handle. In difficult moments, when he was tempted to doubt the value of his own work, my father took deep satisfaction in the knowledge that hundreds of people had been able to use their talents and support their families thanks to his initiative. Now, my father was a practicing Catholic all his life. I never heard him refer to the church's social teaching. I doubt he ever studied it. But the vocation of the business leader, as I just described it, would have stirred and inspired him. This first session of this year's conference, this afternoon, offered us other admirable examples of conscientious social entrepreneurs whose inclusive strategies and hiring practices show that enterprise can have service at its heart. Last September, Pope Francis told a joint session of the U.S. Congress, quoting his own social encyclical, Laudato Si, that business is a noble vocation, directed to producing wealth and improving the world. It can be a fruitful source of prosperity for the area in which it operates, especially if it sees the creation of jobs as an essential part of its service to the common good. Yet the view is undoubtedly widespread in the United States, based on Pope Francis' criticisms of the inequities of globalization, that this Pope is not a fan of capitalism and business. Some American Catholics of an economically liberal bent argue that the Pope, who has described himself as allergic to all things economic, is speaking from a narrow range of experience when he criticizes business. They say his real target is crony capitalism, that is to say, practices that rely on governmental favoritism. They insist that the Pope cannot be thinking of the United States or of similar economic systems in the West when he denounces laissez-faire economic policies that he says rely on faith in a deified market, or economic systems that must make war in order to survive, or that plunder nature in order to maintain their frenetic pace of consumption. It is true that the Pope used much milder and much more optimistic language about business when he came to the United States. Addressing Congress, he did not repeat his condemnations of an exponentially growing gap between the rich and poor. Instead, he hailed progress in bringing people out of extreme poverty, and he recognized that harnessing the spirit of enterprise is essential to the creation and the distribution of wealth. Polls show that the Pope's apostolic journey to the U.S. led Americans of all faiths to adopt a more favorable view of the Catholic Church. Nevertheless, this effect was markedly stronger among those with the center-left political views than it was among self-described conservatives, who, broadly speaking, in the United States represent the so-called pro-business sector of public opinion. But business people, like people in every other line of honest work, want deeply to believe that their work is noble and possessed of greater meaning than mere personal gain. They thus make up a highly receptive audience for the encouragement and the guidance of the Church's social teaching, whether it is articulated by the Holy Father or by others, such as the Centesimus Annus Pro Pontificia Foundation. At a moment when so many have lost trust in major institutions, public and private, the Catholic vision of business leadership remains powerfully convincing and appealing, with potential, I think, to capture the imagination and raise the standards of its practitioners within the church and beyond. Thank you.